I would like to introduce Stacy Littlefield. She is the master herbalist and lead product formulator for Red Remedies. We're going to be talking about self-care for caregivers, managing caregiver stress. Welcome, Stacy.
Hi.
So excited to have you here. I know so many of our families out there, especially our families, you know, with children with autism, you know, just one number one thing that they're dealing with is anxiety and stress and just not enough time in their day. So we love that we're talking about self-care. What is self-care?
Well, self-care includes any intentional action that a person would take to care for their own mental, emotional, spiritual, and physical health.
And so why is self-care so important?
Well, it's really important, especially when we're talking about, subjects that with kids that have special needs, and there are so many parents involved, the parents are the caregivers. And one of my favorite quotes about self-care is from Eleanor Brown. She's a life coach, and she says, you cannot serve from an empty vessel. So if the parent or the caregiver is him or herself, low on energy, doesn't have the emotional resilience and strength, then, they can't care for their family. Caregivers have to pay attention to their own health so that they're there and they're present when their child or loved one needs them. So self-care is really the practice of prevention, to prevent, some emotional instabilities, emotional breakdowns, or physical illnesses. And it's something that so many of us don't do. It's easy to get caught up in the minutiae of the day. You're so busy, making meals, attending to your child, scheduling, getting them, to the different programs they have to participate in. And people forget that caring for your family absolutely includes caring for yourself.
And why is it so difficult for the caregivers to take time out for themselves?
I think caregivers, especially parents, view self-care as a selfish act. I think parents have, and caregivers have, some guilt involved, and they question, why should they take time for themselves when their children need so much? And is it fair that I take time for myself when I could be doing something more for my child? The most important step in self-care is really letting go of that notion, letting go of the notion that taking care of yourself is a selfish act, because it really isn't.
It's funny that you say that, because I, I'm a mother of a child with special needs myself, and I know especially in the beginning, it was really hard to be able to even just go get my hair cut, because I felt so, guilty, like you were saying. I felt so much guilt, like, oh gosh, here I am, I need to get my hair done, I need to get my hair cut, and, but I need to do X, Y, and Z for my child. And so you almost sometimes get into this victim role, and it's hard to get out of, because you feel like if I do this, then, people are going to think this about me, or if I do this, I'm not a good mom. So I can definitely relate to what you're talking about. Or more, when you're talking about, caregivers and taking time for themselves, are they more at risk for certain health conditions if they don't take care of themselves?
The caregivers are absolutely at risk for many different health conditions. Caregivers report more frequent bouts of sleep deprivation, poor eating habits, failure to rest when they're sick, and postponement or failure to make medical or health appointments when we look at non-caregivers. So caregivers have those types of behaviors that lead to an increased risk for depression, increased risk for anxiety, obesity, high blood pressure, and other cardiovascular issues when we compare the caregiver group to the non-caregiver group.
And so, why are they more at risk for these health conditions? Is it because they're not sleeping and not taking care of themselves and not eating right, or is it even more than that?
Well, the core issue that's common to all of those health conditions is chronic stress. It's the stress of caregiving, and there's actually a name for it. It's a specific type of stress known as caregiver stress. And chronic stress, it absolutely affects our physical body systems. Your body has to spend a lot of energy to adapt to those stressful situations. You know, your body is constantly striving to be in a state of balance. So chronic stress disrupts the balance. And so your brain has to adapt to those changes. And all of those changes come at a price. And it's that price that leads to these chronic diseases like heart disease and high blood pressure, depression, and anxiety.
And so what are some warning signs of caregiver stress? Like, what is something that they can look at and go, gosh, oh my goodness, there's a red flag right there. You know, what are some of these signs?
Well, some of the signs of caregiver stress include, you know, feeling tired most of the time, regardless of like how much sleep you get. You're just tired and exhausted. You have frequent feelings of being overwhelmed, even when it's not, even when the situation at hand isn't necessarily an overwhelming situation, like, you know, preparing a quick lunch of like a you know, a cold lunch of sandwiches, but yet you feel like, oh my gosh, I can't do this right now. If people have frequent disruptions in sleep patterns, frequent bouts of sadness, lots of headaches, short tempers and mood swings, it's really important to recognize these signs early and act to make changes. Because once someone gets to the point where they're absolutely overwhelmed, they're not even going to have the ability to act. They're going to be so lost in the stress that they don't even know what to do next.
And so what are some tools to help people manage, I guess what you're saying, caregiver stress, which I bet you there are just so many of the families dealing with autism that have this. And I've been in the community for 11 plus years, and I've never actually even heard that term of caregiver stress. And I think that including myself, I've definitely dealt with that. You know, what can we do? What are some practical steps, and, you know, what are some tools?
Well, there are a lot of different tools that we can use to manage stress, and they come in all different shapes and sizes. And one of the best ways to manage stress is exercise. Exercise will promote better sleep. It increases energy. It eases tension by helping your body and brain balance neurotransmitters so that you have, let's say, for example, it'll keep your levels of serotonin high, which is kind of your happy feel-good neurotransmitter, so it helps to balance those. Journaling can be a part of stress management and is often included in a stress management program. You know, getting your feelings and your frustrations out, even if it's on paper, is a really good tool to relieve stress, because that act of writing all those things down really just helps you purge a little bit. And journaling is a private way to communicate. If people aren't comfortable speaking with somebody, journaling is a really good tool, and it doesn't take a lot of time. People can also practice different types of meditation. And I know that that might seem a little, you know, lofty to some people, but it's not difficult to do. And there's a specific type of meditation that's called mindfulness meditation that is a really good tool for people who are under chronic stress, just repeated chronic stress. And they actually use it in the Veterans Health Department to help people with PTSD. And mindfulness meditation, it lies in the foundation of mindfulness, which is increased awareness and acceptance of the present. So you're paying attention, and you don't judge yourself. And you don't judge the details of your experiences in your life as you're meditating. So you don't reject any negative emotions. You let them come and go as they are. And clinical studies on mindfulness meditation show that they people who practice mindfulness meditation are better equipped to be in the moment. They deal with less issues associated with guilt. They have less anxiety, less depression. It lowers blood pressure. They actually use it for people who have cardiovascular disease to lower their risk of, a cardiac episode. And like I said, they use it for PTSD. So that's a really good tool for people to use to manage stress. And you don't need to block out like an hour to sit down and meditate. If you can find 15 minutes of quiet, you can practice that form of meditation.
And where can they find information about mindfulness meditation? Is it something they can go online for? Is there books? Is there CDs or, things they can download on their phone?
Yep, there are different resources on the internet. And there's actually a magazine that is dedicated to mindfulness and mindfulness meditation. So there are lots of different places where they can go. There's lots of different blogs on Psychology Today's website on mindfulness and mindfulness meditation. There are different books that are available, and there are different websites. There's actually a website that people can go to that will walk them through how to practice mindfulness meditation. And if they go to Psychology Today's website and search mindfulness meditation, they'll find the article that talks about how to do it and what it's all about and, incorporating mindfulness meditation into your daily routine.
So you listed so many great tools and strategies for people out there that are just dealing with so much stress. Do you also recommend if it's a guy having stress or a girl having stress, do you recommend girls' night out or guys' night out? Or if it's a husband and wife, do you recommend trying to carve out some time, whether it be a lunch date if the children are in school or a dinner date? I mean, will any of that help stress as well?
Absolutely. I think that, especially if, a husband and wife and they're a team and they're the primary caregivers for their child, taking time out to preserve that relationship and to preserve that kind of united front is really, really important. And just carving out, just one evening a week or, every other weekend, go have a cup of coffee, do something, is really going to reduce stress. If, you have a group of, girlfriends or guy friends, just, stepping out and taking time away from the situation, taking time outside of the home is really going to be beneficial to reduce stress also. And I know that there are lots of resources for respite care where, other caregivers will come in and afford the time for the primary caregivers to take time out for themselves and to just, take a break from being the primary caregiver and to, be an adult, to live in an adult world and have adult conversations and, talk about something other than, the tasks at hand.
I think that's such great advice because I know myself, it took a long time. I mean, it took probably 3+ years for myself to even take any time out just to do anything that was non-related to autism because you're eat, breathing, and sleeping autism. You're, you're reading every book you can find. You're online 24 hours a day when you're not working, either with your child or just working if you're working outside the home. And it's very hard to figure out, when is me time? And now I make sure to take time for myself at least once a week. And whether that be I go out with, another person and talk about anything and everything other than autism or, sometimes I just go out by myself and have a nice meal. Even if it's just for an hour, I live in Southern California, so, sometimes I'll go and just take a walk on the beach for a half an hour. And when I come back, I feel so rejuvenated. I feel Like, I literally feel as though I'd had multiple days off, even if it was just a couple of hours or even an hour, because, you know, you're so in it. You know, it's kind of like when you're living it day in, day out, just to kind of walk away from that just for a moment really helps be able to do the rest of the day-to-day stuff that you have to do. And I think a lot of times as moms and dads out there, we feel like, oh, we don't have time for that. But if we don't make time for that, especially all the tools and things you're talking about, you know, this is a real thing, this caregiver stress. You know, we're not going to be able to understand how to help our kids in the best way we can. Does that make sense? Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, that's absolutely what I'm trying to say. And it's, you know, it goes back to that quote from Eleanor Brown. You can't serve from an empty vessel. If you have nothing to give, that's not helpful. It's not helpful to your family. It's not helpful to yourself. And I think with, you know, you were talking about, you know, reading about autism and reading every book that you have and, you know, reading all of the different information out there. And I think that in and of itself can be an incredible source of stress, that it's hard for people to decide, is this important information? How do you figure out what you really need to focus on and what you can kind of set to the side? You know, I love that we have access to so much different information at our fingertips, but it can be really overwhelming because I think people think I have to read everything possible, anything I can get my hands on, because if I don't, I might miss something. I might miss that one detail that, you know, might lead to, there's some, again, we go back to guilt. There's some guilt in that. But I think it's really important to kind of take stock and look at the total amount of information that's out there and break it down into little pieces, break it down into chunks and say, well, okay, well, this week I'm going to focus on this topic. And, you know, these are the top three, you know, websites I'll look at instead of trying to take it all in at once and learn everything that there is to know in a really short period of time.
I think you definitely are speaking to these parents that's a lot of things that they're doing right now. They're trying to absorb so much information and they're trying to remember so much. And what ends up happening is you can't filter out or you can't actually see straight sometimes, at least in my experience of, you know, with my own son. Another thing that I do is, you know, I didn't used to, but when my son would have therapists come to the house, I would be sitting there watching the entire therapy from another room and, you know, making sure everything was okay. And really what I should have been doing is, you know, putting on my headphones and maybe, you know, escaping through music. You don't always have to go somewhere. It could just be the next room. Or I do, sometimes I'll just go and, you know, buy a couple of what I call like the veggie magazines that are, you know, all about the celebrities or whatever else. That is like looking at the pictures really. And just to look at something that has nothing to do with everyday life. And that sometimes that little 10 or 15 minute escape can really help. So I love these tips. I love these strategies. I love these tools for these families because I really think this is one of the number one things that, you know, causes not just stress within ourselves, but it causes stress within our marriages and in our friendships and just our family units, you know, as a whole. Now, you mentioned exercise. Are there certain types of exercise that are more beneficial in managing stress than others?
Yeah, I think some people like to run. I personally, I'm not a runner, so that wouldn't be, you know, an exercise that I would go to. And some people find a lot of solace in being able to do that. But time and time again, yoga has proven to be one of the best exercises that someone can incorporate into a stress management program. You know, yoga is a practice that's thousands of years old. It's a part of the Hindu tradition from India. And it has, you know, in that tradition, there it has different levels of, you know, physical attributes, spiritual, mental, and emotional attributes. But in yoga, you have a combination of physical movement, you're stretching, balancing, you're learning to find your center, paired with breathing control, which is basically meditation. You're meditating while you're doing yoga, because you're so focused on your breath and your breathing and your movement that you aren't thinking about anything else. You're just thinking about what's going on in the moment and in the present. And there have been several clinical studies to show that different schools of yoga reduce stress that co-occurs with many different health conditions. So they've studied yoga for depression and anxiety in lots of different populations over a wide range of age groups. They've even studied different yoga programs in children that have ADHD and other behavioral disorders. So depending upon what a child is able to accomplish, there are yoga programs out there for children with special needs, because it does just kind of help them let go and focus on something, on an individual, just the breathing aspect of it. Yoga, like I said, it's one way to also practice meditation at the same time. And there are yoga classes everywhere. It's one of the exercises that is done in a group setting, which I think can be really beneficial, again, for adults to have adult interaction that has nothing to do with, the day-to-day caregiving aspect. It's time outside of the house, outside of the minutiae of the day and, the daily schedule. So, sign up for a yoga class. Let your yoga instructor know, why you're taking yoga and what you hope to, gain from taking a yoga class. Because a lot of instructors will tailor a personal program for your specific needs. And they can teach you in the best school of yoga, using the best method of yoga for what your personal situation requires. And I don't think a lot of people realize that. They just think, oh, yoga, I'm stretching, I'm holding different poses. But there's lots of different schools. But the one thing they have in common is that they all reduce stress. I think it's the best way to reduce stress, because it's low impact and anybody can do it, regardless of, physical limitations that you have, because they've even done clinical studies in, people that struggle with chronic pain and have chronic pain issues. They're still able to get through, yoga classes and adhere to a yoga program and get benefits.
Well, and I know I don't know of all the different areas, but I know in Southern California, there's even, especially if you live in an area that's more out, where you can go outside more, and it's probably seasonal in other places, but I know they even have free yoga classes, at the beach or at the parks where people meet up. So it doesn't even mean that you have to spend a lot of money on this, right?
Oh, absolutely. I live in a small town in Northwest Indiana, and every summer the city has free yoga classes in different parks around in different neighborhoods of the city. And they also offer like Tai Chi classes, which is from traditional Chinese medicine. It's a little similar to yoga. There's more movement, but again, it's really great for stress reduction. So yeah, it can be something that's free, that doesn't cost you anything, but some time. And so it's become such a popular thing, a popular exercise in the United States. It's, grown in popularity. About, it went from like 30% of people in 2001 participating in yoga programs to almost 50% 3 years ago.
Wow.
So there are so many different yoga classes available all over the country. And like you said, many of them, they're free. You can just go and join up in a group, and that can be your self-care for the day or your self-care for the week if that's what you can accomplish.
And I know even if your child's in school, if you have access to the internet, I know YouTube probably offers some things with yoga and other meditation things. I mean, you can Google almost anything and download almost anything nowadays. So
oh, yeah.
Finances, Finances are an issue. It doesn't have to be when for a lot of these things that you're talking about. This is all stuff that they can access and have it not cost nearly anything, if anything. So that's really exciting. Now, are there any other strategies that you can think of that we haven't covered already that help manage stress?
Yeah, I think when people think about stress management, they don't think about supplements. And they don't think about what supplements can do to help manage stress. And I think part of that's because a lot of people don't know about, the tools we have on that side. So there's a group of botanicals, a group of plants that are called adaptogens. And those adaptogen herbs are, they've been used for thousands of years. They originate from systems of medicine like traditional Chinese medicine and Ayurvedic medicine, and they've been used to help balance the body and balance the body with the mind, and a lot of them have significant clinical research.
And I love that, you know, all these tips and tools for all the people listening out here. I mean, you're giving such practical things that they can do right now. They don't even have to, like, wait to do a lot of this stuff. They can do it right now, today, you know, right after they get done listening, which is very, very, very helpful. Now, how does you talked about supplementation. How much does nutrition impact the brain and body's ability to manage stress?
Well, nutrition is key, absolutely key for helping the body manage stress. There are several important nutrients that are depleted from the body at a really rapid rate when people are under chronic stress. So, for example, magnesium. Magnesium is, I think people, you know, when they think about magnesium, they think about bone health or heart health. And what a lot of people don't realize is that you need magnesium in your brain in really large amounts. You know, magnesium participates in over, 350 different enzymes. It's a piece of 350 different enzymes in the body and different metabolic processes, a large portion of which deal with brain function. And your body's ability to adapt and cope with stress all starts with your brain. And magnesium leaves quickly because your brain soaks up so much of it in order to create neurotransmitters, in order to convert non-active forms of B vitamins to active forms of B vitamins. So magnesium is really important when people are dealing with chronic stress. Another nutrient that's depleted from the body really quickly are B vitamins, especially B6, folate, B12. Those three B vitamins play really crucial roles in brain function where it comes to neurotransmitter production, but they also play significant roles in DNA replication and, cell division. So when someone's under chronic stress, you get more mistakes in your DNA. So that's what leads to chronic disease. And, the B vitamins are water soluble. They leave the body quickly. And if we think about some of the behaviors that we mentioned earlier that caregivers report, poor diet was one of them, poor eating habits. And so if we're reaching to quick, fast foods that are low in nutrients, we're not getting enough magnesium, we're not getting enough B vitamins. That all takes a toll on your brain function, and it takes a toll on your brain's ability to help you adapt and cope with chronic stress.
And I know a lot of the families out there, especially the moms that are just running like crazy. And I know there's dads out there too, so I don't want to exclude them, right? But I know we don't eat right. A lot of times I know I talk to so many moms and they say, oh my gosh, I forgot to eat today, or I forgot to even drink water today. So, I mean, I can completely see how they are depleted and they're not balanced out. And so it's so important to eat right, and it's so important to look to make sure that, that everything is balanced within the system, whether it be the vitamins, the supplements, just nutrition altogether. And I just think us as moms, we're the last person to take care of ourselves,
And you know, I can totally empathize with that. I have two young children, and I'm so focused on getting them what they need nutrition-wise, and so focused on, okay, today, you know, balanced breakfast, balanced lunch, that I'm just eating whatever's there. And if it's, you know, a granola bar, then that's my breakfast. You know, I'm more focused on the kids. And for so many moms and dads of kids that are on the autism spectrum, a lot of them are doing really specific dietary interventions, gluten-free, specific carbohydrates, you know, doing different diets that incorporate, you know, high amounts of omega-3s and essential fatty acids, that, you know, they should just, you know, jump in, change the diet for the whole family. Because all of those diets that are focused on, you know, eating foods that are not processed, organic, whole foods, fresh fruits and vegetables, your entire family is going to benefit from that. And, you know, just everybody should be eating that way. And I think that, you know, especially for parents, like you said, we're so focused on getting our kids exactly what they need nutrition-wise that we don't do that first. It's really, you know, it's not funny, but it's kind of funny when you think about it. Just, you know, I made my kid this perfect lunch, and I'm going to have, you know, a piece of bread with some peanut butter on it. So that's my lunch.
Oh my goodness. Or you're running and you're just grabbing, you know, one thing to snack on it while you're driving in the car. And it's, you know, we all do this. I think everybody at some point in their life, you know, hasn't prioritized themselves. And it's really about prioritizing what's important. And, you know, I've said this many times throughout, you know, just talking in the community, but I think it really makes sense, you know, talking with you today. When you go on an airplane, with, you know, if they always talk about if there's an emergency and the oxygen mask come down, they always say, make sure you put it on you first and then put it on your child. And yet we don't even do that in everyday life. You know, we're out of oxygen almost, and we're out there running on nothing. And so many of the things you're talking about are things that I think we know to do. We just need someone to kind of tell us to do it, you know?
Right.
Now let's talk about sleep. What can people do to get better quality of sleep? Because I know as moms and dads out there, that's probably one of the number one things that we're missing. We're not really prioritizing sleep. We're trying to do too much in one day. So what can we do to get better quality of sleep?
Well, exercise is a great way to get a better quality of sleep. Doing regular exercise does help to promote better sleep patterns. The right nutrition will help with sleep patterns. Like I said before, magnesium, all those B vitamins, they play a role in brain function. They play a role in creating the chemicals that help us fall asleep and stay asleep. So making sure you're eating well, and you're getting enough of those nutrients is really important. The botanicals that I mentioned earlier, adaptogens. So that class of botanicals also helps with sleep patterns. And the longer you use them, the better quality of sleep that people get. And what's beautiful about the adaptogens is that, you know, they don't have, I think people are wary of using different botanical-based medicines for sleep, because they're afraid they're going to sleep so well that they're not going to wake up. I think they're afraid that they're going to be knocked out or sedated instead of sleeping well. But the great thing about adaptogens is that they don't have that quality. It's not like Ambien where you are just being knocked out. It's helping your body reset and rebalance. And then there are other herbs like hops and lemon balm, California poppy. Those things can just reduce tension at bedtime so that you're less tense physically. Now, when your muscles are relaxed and your body's relaxed, you're physically relaxed, it's going to be a lot easier for you to fall asleep. So there are lots of different ways you can incorporate, you know, exercise with nutrition or botanicals and nutrition to help get a better quality of sleep. And also, you know, different behaviors that, you know, we do before bedtime. I think, you know, every mom will probably remember a conversation with the pediatrician saying bedtime routines are very important. You know, even when you have infants, to have a routine, to have, you know, we do this, this, and this before bedtime so that your child, you know, learns to go to sleep. Well, we need to do the same things. I think so many of us are, well, I'm going to go through Facebook right before I go to bed, or while I'm laying in bed, I'm going to pick up my iPad and, you know, do this or that. That light is not good. Like, we need to unplug from our electronics and keep them out of the bedroom as much as possible. Create an environment that is conducive to sleep instead of stimulation. So having routines for adults is just as important as having, you know, sleep routines established for babies and for kids.
Well, you mentioned picking up the phone or the iPad. I mean, I think so many of us are guilty of that. And, you know, we go to bed to then wind down, and, you know, is what we kind of convince ourselves of, right? But the wind down then takes over an hour and a half by the time you get on Facebook or looking at emails or reading stuff on, you know, Yahoo News or wherever you're doing. You know, those are things that are actually stimulating your mind and making it harder for you to go to sleep, as you were talking about. And so
yeah.
We really just need to put it down, right? We need to
yeah.
put that down and go to sleep, right?
Exactly. Just unplug. It's so hard to just, you know, just detach yourself. We're so stimulated all the time. And, you know, so many of us don't know how to disconnect. We need to disconnect sometimes. It's good for our brains to be bored. You know, our brains, when we're bored, our brains are doing things like, oh, okay, well, now it's time to kind of file all this stuff, all this information away. So being bored isn't necessarily a bad thing.
Just turning off, because that's what nighttime is supposed to be about. It's supposed to be about turning off, shutting down for the day, you know, and just letting your body kind of recuperate. And I think, and granted, I am much better talking about it than doing it, because I'm very guilty of not turning things off. And I definitely will later tonight after talking with you.
Yeah.
So hopefully everyone listening, at least maybe you just practice that, even if you say, I'm going to try it one night or two nights. And a lot of times we try to do everything at once, and then we fail. So even if you just say, okay, you know, Tuesday and Thursday, I'm not going to even touch my iPhone or my iPad, and just see how that works for you. Or even Tuesday, Wednesday. I mean, I have a girlfriend that her and her husband were, when they would go to sleep, they were both just on their phones for hours before they fell asleep. And so now they have a new rule that the phones are left in the kitchen, plugged in, being charged. And they actually bought an old-fashioned alarm clock, because that was their excuse of why their phones had to be in the bedroom, was the alarm clock. So they just bought alarm clocks and basically decided that they were going to unplug, as you were talking about, leaving their electronics in the kitchen so they weren't even tempted. And then when they went to sleep, they went to sleep. And I just thought, you know, what a great, great idea. Now, granted, I have not adapted that into my life yet, but I definitely see how there's definitely a great benefit to that. And I think we should all really think about that. Now, how does someone begin practicing self-care?
And you mentioned this earlier, where we try to accomplish everything at once. And, you know, establishing self-care is all about baby steps. We're not going to change ingrained behaviors overnight. You know, we need to realize that these are learned behaviors. We learn to be this way. And changing behavior takes time. And you do it in baby steps. You know, one of the first things that someone needs to do is to identify their hurdles, identify their personal barriers to practicing self-care. You know, let go of the perception that self-care is a selfish act. Try to let go of any of the guilt that's involved in that. And that takes time. That takes time, and it takes patience. People need to ask for help when they need it. And I think that so many of us, especially caregivers, don't ask for help when we should. I think that people have a perception that if they ask for help, that means that they failed. And it's absolutely not, you know, an example of failure. Not everybody can do everything all the time. We can't be super mom 100% of the time, 24/7, every single day of the week. So asking for help is really important. Identify certain problem areas that you may have in the day. Are there certain tasks where you need extra help? Are there certain activities that would be easier to grasp if you had an extra set of hands there, or if you had some extra support? And then make a plan and share it. Share it with your husband. Talk about it together. This is what I'm going to do. You know, I want to take every Wednesday evening to go have, you know, a cup of coffee, to go do yoga. Help someone else. Let someone else help you be accountable for taking care of yourself, for taking responsibility for your emotional and physical well-being. So, and just remember that, you know, baby steps, little changes, and, you know, let it happen over time. You know, it's not something that's going to change tomorrow, but it's certainly something that we can start working on. So, and, you know, taking that, you know, time to do the prep work. I know that I bought a house that was 150 years old. And when we were remodeling the house, a friend of mine who's in construction was telling us, it's all about the prep work. If you're going to, you know, take off the wallpapers and repaint your walls and refinish your cabinets, it's all about the prep work. So it's the same thing with self-care. So do the prep work, identify the personal barriers, identify the problem areas, make a plan, and then start to incorporate the practices.
Well, I love how you say baby steps. I remember one of the first things I did years ago just to do something was, I remember it seemed like in the evenings and the weekdays was always easier because then my son's father was home and I could say, okay, I'm going to go do something, you know. And sometimes as moms, and I'm sure other moms can probably relate to this that are listening, you'd go to the supermarket and you might take the long way to the supermarket and the long way home, right, just to be able to listen to the radio, that extra 5 minutes. Or, you know, I would do this. I would take the magazines when I'd be at the grocery store, and I would literally walk through the aisles kind of reading the magazine, and, like, you know, you'd be in front of the frozen food section, and just all of a sudden you look up and go, wow, 10 minutes went by.
Right.
You know, just having that, you know, that little bit of time. And then I took the next step to say, okay, I'm now going to maybe just go to Barnes & Noble and get a cup of, you know, tea and, you know, read a book, even if it was just a chapter, and then come home. And just little things like that really can just make a huge, huge difference. So I hope the people that are listening realize that it's just that one thing, and it's just taking that first step, whether it be just putting your headphones on or whether it be meditating or doing a yoga class, even looking at YouTube doing yoga, you know. It's just that one, even if it's only one thing a month that you get to do in the beginning, because honestly, you know, a lot of us that have children with autism, I'm not going to say it's easy because it's not. But I do find, you know, over 11 years later, it is easier for me to find time to take care of myself. Now, for what I'd like to ask you is, how can a person practice self-care if he or she perceives there isn't enough time? Because I know, you know, I am a very busy person, just like many others, and I have to literally schedule it. What do we tell those people that are looking at their schedule saying there just isn't enough time?
Self-care doesn't necessarily require large blocks of time. I think, you know, as busy as we are, if we really sit down and look at our day, you can find 10 minutes. You can find 5 minutes. If that means taking a shower for 5 minutes longer, sitting in the bath for 5 more minutes, you know, finding 10 minutes to walk around the block, that's all it takes. We don't need to devote hours every day to self-care, but minutes. Allow yourself some minutes. And I think if you just look at it that way, in small pieces, then we can find the time. I think, again, if it comes to, you know, the personal barriers, you need to identify and really just let go of the notion that this is selfish. We can find 10 minutes out of the day. If, you know, if even if it's, like I said, just taking an extra 5 minutes in the shower in the morning, or, you know, standing in the long line at the grocery store as opposed to the short line. You know, those are all ways that we can incorporate time for self-care into our days.
Now, how important is it to set goals for self-care?
Goal setting is really important for any established behavior that we're trying to change. I think that if we don't go into something with a plan, it's really easy to fall off the rails and not follow through. So you start small. Like I said before, it's baby steps. So set goals that can be accomplished. For example, I'm going to take 5 minutes, 3 days a week, for myself. Start with little things like that, like you mentioned earlier, driving the long way to the grocery store, and keep setting bigger and bigger goals. It helps us remain accountable. It helps us establish routines for self-care. And it helps us realize that no matter how busy we are and no matter how hectic our days might be, it's absolutely possible to make time to take care of ourselves. And it's okay to do that. And so goal setting is a really good way just to keep yourself on track. I mean, I'm sure that we're all setting goals. We're setting goals for ourselves every day with scheduling and different, things that we need to accomplish. And so, doing the same thing for self-care is just as important. So because it's so easy to lose track of that and to give it up. You start, I'm going to do this, take a walk 5 minutes and you do that for the first few weeks and then you don't move on to the next step. Well, you're going to fall right back into that cycle of behaviors where you're neglecting yourself. So having a plan and setting goals is really important just to make sure that you're taking responsibility for yourself.
Now, you talked about physical health. Can you address emotional health? How does that relate when we're thinking about self-care?
Well, physical health, we think of exercise and the great stuff that it does for us physically, but self-care helps us practice like emotional hygiene sort of. We wash our hands to get all the dirt and grime off, and I think wash the negativity off our emotions. It's time for us to clear our heads, to be present and in the moment, and that leads to better emotional health. And we know that people who are under chronic repeated stress, like caregiver stress, they are more prone to developing depression. There is a statistic from the American Caregiver Alliance that 50% of caregivers have clinical depression. 50%.
Wow.
That is such a huge number, and we can pull that number back if we take time to address our health, and that includes our emotional health. Like I said, doing yoga, doing meditation, it's so great to reduce stress, and that has a huge impact on our emotional health. And like you said, taking time outside of the caregiver role, letting to be yourself, to be the person that you are, to just be is really important for our emotional health. I think, outside of the increased risk for high blood pressure and cardiovascular disease, that when I was doing research for this interview, that statistic, it shocked me. I was shocked that half of caregivers across the board, whether it's, caring for a child with autism or caring for a parent, 50% of caregivers are clinically depressed.
Wow.
It's astounding.
That's crazy. Especially with, so many of our grandparents that need to be taken care of. I know there's a whole set of people out there that are taking care of elderly people, and that's, you know, I know that that weighs on them, and then on top of now having all of our other children that are, you know, dealing with autism and other disabilities, and just in general, just who knows what else they might be taking care of and whom they might be taking care of. But for 50% to have, I mean, that just seems crazy. That's, we definitely need to start taking better care of ourselves, because if the caregiver people can't take care of the people, who's going to take care of the caregivers?
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, it was really, like I said, I was just blown away by that number. It's such a huge number.
Now, what would you consider the biggest stumbling block to self-care for caregivers?
I think one of the biggest stumbling blocks is asking for help. I think especially moms, and I can relate to this because I'm a mother, I feel guilty when I can't do everything that my child needs. And I can't imagine like what your role as mom is to a child that has special needs. It's so much, you know, more, you know, I don't want to say more involved, but there's, you have so much more to be mindful of, that, you know, it's difficult to say, I can't do this myself and I need some help. I think there's so much guilt that envelops that need, especially for the mom, especially for women. I think that, you know, we are caregiver. You know, historically, women have been the caregivers in the home. We take care of the home. We take care of the kids. It's what we're expected to do. So when we can't do it all, we're so guilty that we're afraid because we don't want to be viewed as failures or bad parents. So I think that's one huge stumbling block. I think another big stumbling block is the perception that there's not enough time. Like I said earlier, there is time. Everybody has 5 minutes in their day, and we need to not think of this as a selfish act. Self-care is not selfish. It's a necessity to preserve and prevent, you know, different health conditions, and to preserve your wholeness as a person. So I think those are the two biggest stumbling blocks for people.
Now, where can people go for more resources and information on self-care?
There are a lot of different resources, especially on the internet. So on the internet, there are a lot of good resources. There's the Family Caregiver Alliance, which is the National Center on Caregiving. So they have a lot of different educational tools. They have a great blog for people to read. The Mayo Clinic website has a great section on stress management specifically for caregivers. Your family doctor is a good resource to go to. You should be, you know, making appointments for yourself, and, you know, your family doctor can be a good place to start, just to say, I don't know, you know, I don't know what to do. I'm having issues with stress, and I need to find a program to help with stress. And, you know, the many different autism support groups out there, you know, join a support group. You're going to find a lot of different resources when you talk to parents who are in the same situation. And I think that, you know, in being, you know, with the internet, we have so many, we have access to so much. We can go to Facebook. There are support groups on Facebook. There are support groups all over the place. So that's where I would start looking, is on the internet. But the Family Caregiver Alliance is a really good place to start for people.
That's wonderful. I feel like the listeners have gotten so much out of all of the tips and tools you've given. I can't believe our hour is almost up here. What is something that you want to leave them with? Like, if you want to leave them with a message, or, you know, what is the most important thing you want them to get out of this?
the most important thing I want people to get out of this is that, you know, if you're the caregiver, if you're the person that your child is dependent on, your health is so important. It's one of the most important things that you can nurture and protect in order to care for your child. Because if you're not healthy, if you wind up getting really sick and you land in the hospital, then you can't be there. So it's not selfish. It is absolutely okay and essential to take time for yourself. And no one is going to fault you for that.
Love that. It's basically minute by minute, step by step, and just take it day by day as you were talking. I have so enjoyed talking with you, Stacey. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having me.